Welcome to Flash Gordon, the official story of the film podcast. This series will look behind the scenes of the forthcoming book that celebrates the making of the movie from 1980. I'm filmmaker and author John Walsh, and I will take you on a journey through time and space to discover how Flash Gordon has become one of the most iconic science fiction films in the last 40 years. I will be speaking with the cast and the crew and fans of the film and giving you an insight into the making of the book. As we lead up to the publication date in October, I will reveal details of forthcoming events, and there'll be a chance to win copies of the book too. This could be a bumpy ride, so for God's sake, strap yourselves down!
Tuesday Takeover with Marshall Julius on Fubar Radio.
We'll be joined by double BAFTA-nominated filmmaker and author John Walsh. Now, I know you're also a huge fan, John, of the camp cult classic Flash Gordon, as are we all, I'm assuming. 40 years old this year. You're working on something quite special for that. Cash in on that, right? Is that what you're up to?
I am, and it's
I mean, to pay due homage to
it. Is it a Peter Duncan Q&A?
It is.
Duncan Peter.
Spare me the madness!
In 4K. In 4K, no. No, I'm working on the first and only official making of Flash Gordon book. In fact, I delivered the first draft this Friday to Titan Books, and the last draft first week of March. So it's been quite frantic for the last year. It's taken me a year to get this project together. It's with King Features, the rights holder for Flash Gordon. And I'm working with Studio Canal, who are the owners now of the Flash Gordon film. And they're working on a new 4K scan, which will be released in May-June time.
Are you getting like a couple of pounds every time you say 4K, John? Because I'm detecting, you know, there's a bit of a theme.
He's trying to bump it up to 8K.
He really likes 4K. Yeah, give me 8K
just
or give me
tell
dead.
Him that we've all got 5K machines.
16K.
Well, I think the really significant thing about it is that there's lots of films from when Ray was making Jason and Clash and so on that were pushed through the Oscars corridor by the studios that were considered to be main pictures that have sat on the shelf and haven't even been scanned for Blu-ray. So it's almost a badge of status, you know. It's an award to say, we're taking this library release and we're going to do something special, and we're going to do this UHD.
Right, so John, it is time now for your Vintage Geek Challenge. Three cheeky questions about your chosen subject, Flash Gordon. Are you ready?
I am. Ah. Excellent.
That actually wasn't the first question, but it was a question. So far the record is one out of three. Can you beat one out of three?
But I won that, and I deserved it.
You know, honestly, the second question was rubbish. The way that I look at it, it's terrible. But still. I can't give it to you. It just wouldn't be fair to John.
We live and learn.
Yeah. But I'm all about prizes, so what incentivises me here? Have I got another book?
Okay, question one.
an extra 2K.
Question one. No one dies in the palace without what?
Without Ming's approval. Without permission from the emperor himself.
Well, what do we say? The direct quote is a command from the emperor. Do we give that to him?
He's answered the question. You didn't ask for a quote. I think even though it works against me.
All right, okay. I'm just checking. Okay,
4K.
That's fine. Okay. Referring to the production problems that plagued the film, who described Flash Gordon as the only improvised $27 million movie ever made?
Oh, the brilliant Mike Hodges, who's written the foreword for my new book.
This boy
excellent.
Well.
Like there. You got him to write the foreword.
Yes, indeed.
Is the book in 4K? Oh.
It is.
Oh, brilliant.
That's awesome.
Okay, question number three. For three out of three and the grand prize, Ming the Merciless says that when he destroys a planet, he calls upon the great god Daizan. Daizan is Japanese for what?
Destroyer?
No.
Hoover?
That's a good guess.
Hold
Hoover.
On. Do this sound. I got this sound every 5 minutes. Thank you very much.
Jeremy Daizan?
That's harsh.
God of...
It's great cruelty.
Oh. My thesaurus would say the same thing.
Yeah.
So, yes, well, that, look, the movie, that's very good. 2 out of 3, still ahead of other people.
Yeah, but it was only 3 questions on one movie. I had to deal with 12 from Stanley Kubrick.
You were the one that said Stanley Kubrick. You could have made it about, you could have said, I want it about me. You know, you have to think ahead. You have to think ahead. The movie was produced by Dino De Laurentiis, right? he and Sam Jones really, is it true they really hated each other?
I wouldn't say that they hated, but there was lots of problems on the film. This book is for the first time speaking to all the participants. And in the case of the great Dino De Laurentiis, of whom I'm an enormous fan and admirer, I've managed to speak to Martha De Laurentiis, his wife. I've spoken to all of the production personnel who are still with us, and some who aren't have lent me their last interviews, from family and friends. So Dino fell out with Sam because Sam walked off the picture before they finished it. So there was lots of big disputes. Sam got into fights during filming.
He was dubbed as well, right? Is that true?
He was looped in by other actors in certain scenes because they had to, because they didn't have Sam for it.
Right.
But most frustratingly, and I think this is where everyone agrees, including Sam, it was a big mistake. When they were doing all of the soft PR on couches, like Good Morning America and so on, and Breakfast News, had it been here at the time, they were sending Max von Sydow, who was a brilliant actor but quite dry person to speak to. When, of course, you want to see Flash from Flash Gordon and Dale Arden and so on. So he wasn't available for all of those tours. And I think that's what helped the film not punch through in America. Whereas in Europe and in Asia, it did extremely well. In the US, it wasn't a great start. But a little interesting fact that even most of the people didn't know on the production, of which the book is full of, Dino tried to buy Pinewood Studios because he was going to make three Flash Gordons back to back.
Oh, God, I would have loved that.
I would have loved that. Exactly.
A little bit of trivia. I actually met Dino De Laurentiis. I went to his house and Martha was there. And it was I was working at Universal Studios at the time and doing distribution deals on the movie Hannibal. And a lot of distributors came in and were asking for lots and lots of money. So I sold Japan and that went for $14 million alone. And when people went into negotiation, they said, well, look, you've got Anthony Hopkins, but you don't have Jodie Foster. And Dino said, and I'm sorry, I'm going to do a crude, hopefully not an offensive Italian impression, but he said, the movies are not called a Clarice. The movies are called the Hannibal. And
that was pretty offensive.
Thank you. So I'm sorry. I really said sorry. That was approved by Dino.
I love Super Mario. It's amazing.
It's a me, Dino. Well, John, thank you so much for coming in. And John's book, Ray Harryhausen and the Lost Movie, is available to buy everywhere. All good bookshops, most bad bookshops, probably just everywhere.
Everywhere. And today it's been nominated for a Rondo Award. So
congratulations.
Tuesday Takeover with Marshall Julius on Fubar Radio.
Copyright in Flash Gordon, the official story of the film podcast, is owned by John Walsh and Titan Books Limited, under license from King Features Incorporated. Audio from the film is courtesy of Studio Canal. This recording may not be reproduced in whole or in part without written permission from us. The views expressed within these podcasts do not necessarily reflect those of the associated companies or its employees. For further terms and conditions, please contact us at our Facebook page, Flash Gordon, the official story of the film.